Morning, ladies, gents, and jerks. This is part 3 of my game-slash-film theory debunk. This one is all about the concept of Forerunner rather than anything MatPat actually said. The first portion will be comparing the 11th century versions of each warrior, and the second will be the warriors at their peaks. There will likely be a lot of overlap with this video and my Knight vs. Samurai series, as well as the second episode of my Deadliest Warrior retrospective review, which I really need to finish. But that is to be expected, since Forerunner is basically Deadliest Warrior, the fantasy game. This trio represents an interesting dichotomy. The samurai and Vikings would have bows while the knights wouldn't. The samurai and knights would have horses while Vikings generally didn't. Knights and Vikings had shields while the samurai didn't. For this battle though, the warriors will all be dismounted, and they won't be using any ranged weapons. Since it's not really fair to the samurai since his opponents have shields that would make it near impossible for him to get a kill, nor would it be fair to the knight who doesn't use ranged weapons. We will be looking at each warrior's pole arm of choice, their sword, and their armor. Let's start with the 11th century Vikings represented today by a Saxon housecarl circa the Battle of Hastings in 1066, which is what many consider to be the end of the Viking Age. For pole arms, the Saxon housecarl would typically use the long axe. The long axe is the most powerful weapon a man can carry into melee during the 11th century. It weighs in roughly at 5 pounds with most of the weight centered at the head. While it hits the hardest and has the highest chance of doing damage through armor, it also is the shortest polearm, measuring usually between 5 or 6 feet. It requires two hands to operate, and a shield was often worn on the back, not just to have it ready for when the sword comes out, but to also provide extra protection to the user's back during a fight. The housecarl would wear a typical broadsword on his hip, which would measure between 30 and 36 inches with a double-edged blade and a slightly tapered tip. It was better suited for cutting, but was still very capable of thrusting. It was almost always paired with a shield, which would either be a kite shield or a center grip round shield. The housecarl would be wearing riveted mail armor over a padded gambeson. This not only makes him immune to cuts, but the riveted mail is extremely difficult to penetrate. The weakness of mail, however, is blunt force and extreme penetrative force. Once an attack busts a ring, the mail no longer presents any resistance to that attack, although it takes something as powerful as a lance from a knight at full gallop, or specifically designed weapons like the military pick, to penetrate it. Next, we will cover the samurai. The samurai's polearm of choice is the yari. The yari is a spear used exclusively in two hands. The standard yari has a long enough blade to deliver cuts, but the tapered point allows it to thrust quite effectively. Out of all the pole arms, the yari could be the longest, with some examples being as long as 20 feet. But for this fight, we will use the middle ground of 10 feet, as a longer yari would be very difficult to use in single combat. The samurai of the 11th century would be using a tachi as their sidearm. The tachi has a stronger curve than the typical katana, and is also notably longer. The typical tachi blade would be about 30 inches, and due to a lack of a shield, it would also be used in two hands. He would be wearing something akin to the domaru, which was a form of lamellar armor. Lamellar is made from small metal plates laced together and was prevalent throughout Asia. The domaru features very large shoulder guards called sode, which were the samurai's shields. Due to the samurai being primarily mounted archers, they couldn't hold a shield in their hands, thus they had to wear them on their shoulders. Lastly, we have the knight, who is being represented today by a Norman knight circa Hastings. Their polearm of choice when mounted would be their lance, which was typically around 10 feet long and was no different to a spear. On foot, a 10-foot spear would be pretty difficult to use with a shield, with most one-handed spears being 6 to 8 foot long, so that's what we're going to give him today. The Norman sword would have a larger cross guard than the Saxon sword and a slightly more tapered point. However, these minor differences in design wouldn't really result in any noteworthy performance differences. Their swords are effectively identical, as would be their shields, as both sides would likely be using a kite shield. The Saxon and the Norman would have the same armor as well. Both would be wearing a mail hauberk and a nasal helmet. Their helmets would usually be worn over a mail coif or have a mail aventail, which would protect the sides of their head as well as their neck. Now that we know the warriors, how would they fare against one another? In terms of pole arms, while the Saxon has the most reliable tool for damaging armored foes, the short reach would make it more difficult for him to put it to use. The longer reach of the samurai would mean that he can strike before anyone else could, while the Norman having both a polearm and a shield means that he'll be the hardest to land a blow on, but he'll also have the least control of the distance. Neither the Norman spear or the samurai's yari could reliably defeat or get around the armor of the others, so in this instance the advantage goes to the Saxon, though there really isn't a clear winner or loser. In terms of swords, the tachi would not only be the shortest of the swords on offer, but also the least effective at dealing with the armor it faces due to the curvature. It also makes the samurai the most vulnerable, as he has no shield, and you don't know just how big of an advantage a shield is unless you've had to face someone with one. The Saxon and Norman will be equally matched as they have the very same equipment. The Samurai is at a steep disadvantage here, with neither the Saxon or Norman really having the edge over the other. In terms of armor, again the Saxon and Norman are perfectly equal, with the Samurai being the outlier. The Domaru and Hauberks weigh in the same ballpark, but the Domaru weighs more heavily on the shoulders than the Hauberk, which would have most of its weight resting on your belt. The Domaru also offers the least in terms of coverage, as the armpits and inside of the arms are mostly exposed, and the throat only has limited protection to the coif or aventail the Saxon and Norman have. The Samurai is at a minor disadvantage here, with the Saxon and Norman again being perfectly equal. Now, the final verdict of the 11th century dismounted melee is that the Samurai is at a disadvantage in most cases, and the Saxon and Norman are essentially the same. If given their full equipment, the Samurai would be very difficult to catch due to being a horse archer, but would have a very difficult time killing the Saxon or Norman due to the shields and armor. The mounted Norman would have the advantage in melee, with the Saxon struggling due to not being able to catch either. However, if the Samurai or Norman stray into long axe range, they will be cut down. Now, for them at their peaks. This time, the Viking I will be using is a Varangian Guard, which was the personal bodyguard of the Byzantine Emperor, and a unit composed almost entirely of Norse mercenaries. Again, the rules will be melee only, and no horses, to give each party the same chance. We will be covering the Varangian first. His armor and weapons would be mostly the same as the Saxon Housecarl. His pole arm of choice would still be the long axe, which, no matter the period, is a devastating weapon, and formed the basis of weapons like the halberd that would come later. His sword would also be the same Spatha-type broadsword, paired this time with a round shield. The round shield is a superb tool for single combat due to it being gripped with a central handle. There are some accounts from the period which describe the Varangians having a weapon which could be interpreted to be something like a Ramphaea, but the account is vague, so we'll just give him the sword and shield instead. His armor would still be riveted mail. His helmet would feature a mail aventail that covers most of his face, giving him superior protection than the Saxon at Hastings. He also gained splinted bracers and greaves covering his forearms and shins, as well as lamellar worn over his mail for even further protection. The Samurai in this fight will be given a Kamayari. The Kamayari is a bit shorter than a normal yari, but features a blade perpendicular to the shaft, giving it a piercing attack similar to a war pick. However, since the perpendicular blade is similar to the standard yari head, it isn't as effective at penetrating as a war pick would be. It does allow the Samurai to hook opponents and their weapons, much like the long axe would, giving him some more offensive options. The Samurai will, of course, be given the katana. The 27-inch blade of a katana is the shortest in the matchup, but despite its short length, it is still in the same weight class as the Varangian's broadsword and the knight's longsword. Again, it's used without a shield and would perform poorly against the armor of the Samurai's opponents. For maximum protection, the Samurai will be given the Nanbando. The Nanbando is an imported 16th century European breastplate integrated into Japanese armor. It would likely be the sturdiest breastplate in this contest, being a bit more advanced than that of the knight and designed to help against matchlock firearms. The knight will be taking a Lucerne hammer as his polearm. The Lucerne hammer is about as long as the long axe and designed specifically for defeating armor. The hammerhead delivers devastating blunt force trauma, the top spike is stiff and slender, making it effective at thrusting through armor or at least gaps in armor, and the crow's beak on the back end is very effective at punching through even plate armor. No matter which bit of the Lucerne hammer you get hit by, you're gonna have a bad time. His sword is, of course, a long sword. This knight will be given an Oakshot type 15A, which has a narrow and highly tapered point well suited for defeating armor. While unlikely to get through the main armor, it is useful for getting into the gaps of the armor, as well as being a lever for grappling. The pommel and guard were also effective striking weapons in their own right. His armor will be Milanese-styled plate armor. The smooth surface allows blows to glance off more easily, and the plates leave very little of the body uncovered, with the bits not covered in plate generally covered with mail. The barbute helmet covers most of the face and is very well suited for a dismounted knight engaging in melee. Now for the comparison. In terms of pole arms, only one has a weapon that can reliably defeat the armor of the others. The long axe can do some serious damage to the Samurai, and the Kamayari would give the Varangian's mail some trouble, but neither the Samurai nor the Viking have the armor to withstand the Lucerne hammer, nor can their weapons reliably damage the knight. While the long axe has the better shot, there is a clear winner here. As for swords, while the shield of the Varangian would make him very difficult to hit, his sword isn't the best choice for defeating plate armor. By the same token, the katana will struggle to do anything against even the mail armor of the Varangian, let alone the plate armor of the knight. The highly tapered point of the longsword in conjunction with the striking potential of the hilt would give the knight the clear advantage in terms of defeating the opponent's armor. In terms of armor, all warriors are wearing roughly the same weight of kit. While the Nanbando is likely the sturdiest breastplate, the rest of the samurai's armor lets him down as he has the most exposed areas of the three. While mail and lamellar of the Viking would be tough, they certainly can't compare to the knight's plate armor. There is a very clear winner in the armor department, and it's the knight. So, across the board, the knight's armor controls the contest. Due to his armor's strength, specialist weapons like the Lucerne Hammer had to be developed, and swords had to be altered to better suit the challenges of the era. The knight's armor is too much for the others to overcome, and it gives him the victory. And that's it. In terms of who is deadliest, the knight's armor grants him the win. In an unarmored and unarmed fight, the samurai's smaller stature would put him at a disadvantage, but ultimately the three would be pretty evenly matched. It is the equipment that shapes this fight and gives the win to the knight. Tally's taking hope.